Don't change a channel, just give me 5 minutes. I ask 5 minutes, and if you still think that you probably want to unsubscribe and leave, that's fine. Just give me 5 minutes. This is a hard one for me to wrap my head around, but you know, when I was a kid, back in the 70s, I was really into like UFOs and stuff. There was a show on the TV called Project Blue Book, and I watched every episode, and it really keyed my interest. And there was another show called In Search Of, narrated by Leonard Nimoy, and they had lots of compelling and interesting and spooky stories about UFOs and stuff. And then, you know, in the 80s, there was the Whitley Strieber books, and I read them, and it was like, wow, this is really out there. And then Unsolved Mysteries did lots of things about UFOs and encounters and stuff like that, and lots of video. And, you know, and then later, a little later on in the 90s, there was the whole thing about crop circles, and I got a book about crop circles, and it was all this documentation and everything. I thought, this is really weird. And then there was even culminated a TV show, I think it was 2020, an American news show, went over to England and did a whole thing about crop circles, and they had night vision cameras set up in this area where it often happened. And then it's like, you know, while they're talking, they say, look over there, and they turn the camera to a field, and all of a sudden there's this huge, like, you know, crop, like art, like punched into the landscape, like just happened like that. And I thought, wow, that's really something. But then I thought, well, you know, all this stuff, so much of it is you know, been debunked. You know, crop circles, they had, you know, couple books written about it, and then it got debunked, or partially debunked, because a bunch of locals claimed that they had made them and showed how they made them, and that they've been doing it for a joke for decades apparently, and made thousands of crop circles just on a laugh. So debunked, I don't know. And then you know, I just, Carl Sagan talked about this a lot, and when he did Cosmos back in 79-80, and he would say, oh, there's not a single shred of evidence, not the tiniest transistor. And, you know, I took that to heart. It's like, well, you know, all this anecdotal evidence, hearsay, people seeing things, some blurry photographs and stuff, it's just not enough. You know, I'm a scientist, this is not enough. So let's just take all that I said, all that, you know, Foo Fighters, and not that Foo Fighters, the original Foo Fighters, the Betty and Barney Hill, and Area 51, and the Roswell. Let's take all that and just throw it in the trash and say it's all bullshit. And then I saw this.
Are you Fox moving target?
No, I took an auto track.
Oh, okay.
Oh my gosh, dude.
Wow, look at that, man. Look at that. What the
Dude, that is going on, bro.
There's a whole fleet of them. Look on the ASA.
My gosh.
They're all going against the wind. The wind's 120 knots from the west.
Look at that thing, dude.
That's not our LNS though, is it? It's not.
That is the LNS, dude.
Well, if there's like
another thing,
it's rotating.
So these three videos were originally leaked in 2017 to the New York Times from someone in the Navy. It purported to show three different encounters with objects from naval aircraft as recorded through the plane's targeting system and target acquisition systems. And these objects are seen in infrared and visible light. They showed up in radar. And one depicts an object moving at supersonic speeds at a lower altitude. Another is an object which is pacing the fighters and doing like rolling around in midair. And another is being targeted by an aircraft at quite a distance, and it simply disappears. Fine, you know, compelling. But last year, in April, the Pentagon was put under pressure from a number of groups to talk about those videos. And last April, 2020, the Pentagon released a statement where they said conclusively that yes, those three pieces of footage are legitimate, and they are actual encounters with unidentified craft. And the Pentagon said that yes, these objects are real, and we do follow them, and we don't know what they are. Okay. So, officially, UFOs exist. Fine. So last August 2020, the Department of the Navy formed an Unidentified Aerial Phenomena Task Force, or the UAPTF, to investigate encounters like this with military aircraft and commercial aircraft and such. And it sort of harkens back to the old Project Blue Book, you know, is it a real scientific, like, group to really gather data, or is it really just to appease the public saying you got to do something about this? We don't know. But putting the capstone on this long story, a couple days ago, the pilots that shot that footage came out and talked about it publicly on 60 Minutes. They had three Navy pilots who talk about not only these recorded encounters, but others. And I wish I could just show you the whole thing in this video, but I put a link in the description. I can't copy it because this video gets slammed and you wouldn't even see it. So go and watch. Just don't take my word for it. Watch. Make up your own mind. But in that interview, the pilots all say conclusively, yes, there's no doubt that these craft exist, they're real, and we encounter them all the time. The one pilot said that in his stint in the Navy that there were periods of time when these aircraft, or I should say these objects, appeared in their airspace almost on a daily basis. And so these objects will come up on military radar and jets would be sent out to intercept. And very often, if they could get close enough to them, they would turn on their weapon systems and get a lock on them and get some video. So these three released videos certainly are pretty good, but they're apparently by no stretch of the imagination the whole thing. I mean, apparently the military has spent decades accumulating data on these objects. And so that leads to the last part of this, which is that unbeknownst to just about everybody, unless you read a newspaper, last year in December, part of the huge emergency relief package that was passed, it's like a 5,500 plus page tome that was meant to deal with the economic problems and COVID and everything last year that passed, crammed into that huge bill is a tiny little caveat which orders the Pentagon to make a report, an unclassified report, of all the information that it knows about these unidentified aerial phenomena and issue that report to Congress within 180 days. And that six-month window is just about coming to a close, so if the Pentagon actually, if they actually submit to this demand by Congress to issue this report, then it would drop sometime in the next month or so. And if they do that, then we might learn a lot more than we've ever known about these things. Whoa, I can't believe I'm saying this. But so let's just get beyond the conjecture about whether or not UFOs exist. Let's just accept that they're real and that they're in our airspace. The real thing is now is like, well, what's the next step? What are the next questions to ask? You know, are they extraterrestrial? Are they coming from another dimension? Are they, what are their intentions? These are the questions. And I hate to say it, it's not a joke. Turns out that Ed Wood was right all along.
What do they want? Where are they from? Where are they going? Flying saucers, Captain, are still a rumor. Officially.
He just didn't really have a way of saying it in a way that really made much sense, but... So there you go. Now what? I'm a scientist. I want to know. I want answers. I think we all should ask answers. I think we should demand the data. I think that we should demand that the Pentagon spill its beans, totally. I doubt they will, because if they know anything about these craft, there have to be immense technologies involved that they don't want to let anyone know. But of course, the stupidity is that these things have been seen all over the globe for decades. So if we've got their technology, then the Chinese have the technology and the Russians have the technology and everything. But I suspect that given the nature of what these objects are, that their technology is probably indecipherable. I would be surprised if there's any like materials technology that could even be like gleaned from these things, you know. They probably don't use electricity or anything like that. But there are some things that we can surmise just from what's been given by these videos and what these pilots have said. One is that these craft are small. They're like about the size of a fighter jet, give or take, or like a size of a bus. They're not huge. So in all the Hollywood depictions of the day that we make contact, like, you know, Independence Day or Arrival or the day the Earth stood still, it's going to be some dramatic, you know, made for the cameras event with like a city-sized craft hovering overhead, or some, you know, alien coming out of a spacecraft in the middle of, you know, in front of a bunch of cameras. That's not what it is. It's these tiny little zippy little, you know, sports car type things zipping all around, coming in and out of our airspace every day, moving at incredible speeds, doing incredible maneuvers, and just coming in, making a thing, doing something somewhere that doesn't seem to make any sense, and then just disappearing. The pilots say that these things, they wink out of, I mean, like into existence, like boom, like that, just appears on radar, bing, it's there. When they get up to it, if they get too close, you know, it just disappears, winks out, like it comes, like winks in and out of space. You might think, well, these, you know, infrared images are compelling, but they're just blobs. Well, but these same pilots, they also carry snapshot cameras with them, and they've taken some pretty intriguing, like pretty close color shots of these various objects from their canopies. They describe these craft moving at many times the speed of sound and not creating any sonic booms. So that gives us some information that these craft are solid. They appear on radar. They come up on infrared. You can see them visually. They actually have a shape, and you can see it's actually like an object with a shape and features on it. Because it's a seemingly solid object that seems to have heat signature, the fact that it's moving at like 1300 miles an hour or something like that and not creating a sonic boom means it's not actually pushing through the air like an aircraft would or like a missile. It's just kind of slipping around, like it's moving in its own space. And the fact that it winks in and out of like existence gives a lot of indication that what we might be seeing is a three-dimensional projection of like a five-dimensional object. When I say projection, not like a hologram, not like a slide projected on a wall, something made out of matter, but a projection for our three-dimensional space. So it would wink in and out because it's kind of like a three-dimensional construct that's kind of poking into our universe and then just being pulled out. It's like Flatland, you know, if you're a three-dimensional person and you discover a two-dimensional world that has no height, and this, everyone knows about this, but Flatland is the thing where you discover this world, this universe, that's only got two dimensions, and you can see it. And, you know, it's two dimensions from above. And you decide you want to explore Flatland, and so you poke your finger down through Flatland. You have the force in the Z-axis to do this. And you put your finger through Flatland, right? And you're kind of feeling around in Flatland, and, you know, and let's say, you know, you can get your eyeball down in there and look around Flatland. Well, the Flatlanders just see you come out of empty space, and they see this object that's sort of round and has this hot kind of weird center core and has these like little dots that are kind of like coming in and out of existence in different spots, and those are our corpuscles flowing through our veins and stuff, because they're only looking at an indefinable cross section of our three-dimensional finger, and what they see makes no sense. It just comes into existence, and then when I pull my finger out, it just, it's gone. And these craft are sort of like that. They just kind of poke in and out of existence. And the reason they can seem to defy all physical laws is they're in their own space. They're not really moving through the air. They're moving around the air, or they're moving in a piece of space that they are occupying that is not really like there. So they might not even like be there. What we might be looking at is a, when we look at this craft, we might be just looking at a hole, you know, that the actual craft might be on the other side of a hole in space-time that it's observing us through, and we might be looking through like a wormhole, you know. So they might not even like be there. We might see the craft, we might reflect, microwaves off of it and see it in radar, but maybe it's not there the way we would think of being there. You couldn't like crash into it, you know. It's like a projection from a higher dimension. So, but these are all things that as scientists we should think about. We should stop arguing about whether they're not. It's been confirmed. The Pentagon says they're real. They're there. They come in and out of our airspace every day. There's nothing we can do about it. We don't know who they are, what they are, what they're doing, any of that stuff. So, time to have a different conversation about this. And who knows, if this report comes out, we'll know more. But, it's interesting in all of the Hollywood depictions of how something like this would go, that when it actually happens and we actually have confirmation from radar, infrared imaging, Navy pilots, and the government saying, okay, yeah. And people just go, nah, it's all bullpucky. Okay. So maybe that's really what happens. Maybe it's just so easy to just say it's too crazy that maybe we really won't take it seriously. But we should. I know I'm thinking about it. Like I said, Ed Wood got it right. Bye.
Many scientists believe that another world is watching us this moment. We once laughed at the horseless carriage, the airplane, the telephone, the electric light, vitamins, radio, and even television. And now some of us laugh at outer space.
Thank you. what you're watching. Friend love, it's what I'm doing. Working at the bench again.